In the last two videos, we have considered the Amplitude Chief King and the Phase Chief King. Both are digital modulation techniques. The first one modulated the amplitude of the carrier, and the second one modulated the phase of the carrier. And we can do both modulations independently to encode two symbols at once, and we can, in effect, we can combine both modulations and we obtain the quadrature amplitude modulation, or in short, QAM. So in the QAM, we modulate both the amplitude and the phase of the carrier. So below here, there is again the diagram of all possible phasor states which can be taken, and an assignment of the symbols here. And this representation is also called the constellation diagram. So we have seen the constellation diagrams in the two videos before too, but now it gets a name here. And the constellation diagram depicts all possible constellations of phasor values. And now you can derive from this constellation diagram, for example, for the symbol 3, you can read the length here of this red line. This will be the amplitude, the length will be the amplitude, and you can read the phase here. And obviously, if you take another symbol, for example the 8, then you get another pair of amplitude and phase. So now both amplitude and phase is changed. And this technique enables us to encode more data into one symbol. So what you see here is the constellation, the possible amplitude phase constellations for one symbol. And as we have 16 states here, we can in effect encode 4 bits. So the formula is 2 power the number of bits is the number of symbols. Number of possible symbols. Yeah. So if you have 16 symbols, take the logarithm to the base of 2 to get the number of bits which can be actually encoded. So number of symbols is our variable KM. So for KM is 16, we can encode 4 bits. Yeah. So in this example, we have 16 states, and this is also called the 16 QAM. QAM is the modulation technique, and the 16 in front of it describes the number of discrete symbol states, or states in the constellation. Yeah, there can be different combinations. So other common values are, for example, 64 QAM, and this can even go to 256 QAM. So one symbol can encode 1 byte. But there can also be lower values, for example, a 2QAM. But this is in fact the same like the phase shift keying example, which we have considered in the previous video, with two discrete states, and this has a special name. It's the BPSK, the binary phase shift keying. Binary means just two states, or the 4QAM is a PSK with four discrete states, and this is also called QPSK. Yeah. Comes from the Latin word quadro, and this means four. Yeah, but however, these examples are just two boundary cases, so they have so less states in the constellation diagrams that they are in effect a PSK. But when we are talking about a QAM, we want to encode more data in one symbol. So these are common values. You can actually choose any number of values, for example, a 24 QAM or a 29 QAM. But as we deal with data generated by a computer, we mainly have values which are a power of 2, so that you can encode a number of bits in one symbol. So this is why these values here are quite common. So now, how is this technically realized? Here again, we have data stream coming from a computer or a digital logic or however. So we have data, binary data, for example. And then we have a symbol mapping. The symbol mapping, for example, maps the binary symbol, so the bits, to, let's take 46 symbols. So we can encode 6 bits in 64 symbols. And these 64 these symbols, which can take 64 possible states, are then given to a QAM modulator. And now the QAM modulator has here this mapping between the symbol numbers here and phase amplitude pair, but the phase amplitude pair is just one representation for a complex number. So what you see here in the constellation diagram is the real axis and the imaginary axis. And remember that there are two equivalent representations for complex numbers. So there's the polar representation consisting of amplitude and the phase. And there is the cotillion, which is the real part plus the imaginary part. Yeah. And now we convert the polar notation consisting of the amplitude and the phase to the Cartesian notation. And we can also read this directly from the axis here. So if we have the symbol of 3, then we can directly read the values from the real and the imaginary axis. Same goes, for example, for 14. And we take the values read from the real and imaginary axis and take the two real values out of the complex number here. So for example, the symbol of 3 is a complex number and symbol 14 is a complex number and so on. So each symbol state generates a complex number, and then we decompose this complex number into its real part and imaginary part, and we consider each part independently. We can then use a digital to analog converter to generate an analog signal. For example, here's a voltage signal. Now, so now this is the boundary between our digital circuit, and now we are in the analog domain and we have an analog circuit here. And here we see our IQ mixer again. And this IQ mixer has two inputs, the in-phase input and the quadrature input. And the in-phase input is just the real value, which is generated by the QAM modulator. And the Q branch is fed by the imaginary part. And now the IQ mixer just mixes this information on this two numbers, so these two signals, we can say, up to the RF band. And now we have a modulated carrier. So here the QAM modulator is actually just another mapping of the symbol to a real value, imaginary value pair, and this is where the actual modulation on the radio frequency carrier happens. So this here is in fact the whole QAM modulator, which is split across the digital and analog domain. Yeah, for example, here you get a symbol stream 14.3, and this maps to a signal 14 is, yeah. Let's draw the diagrams here. So 14 has a negative imaginary value and a negative real value, and now we go to 3, which has a positive real value and also a positive imaginary value. Let's take another example, for example, 8, which has a positive imaginary value too, but a negative real value, and so on. So we have two independent signals here, I signal and Q signal, and remember that those two inputs are orthogonal. So we can use those separate signals, give them into an IQ mixer, and it then can produce the desired output signal. And on the receiver side, the process is reversed. So we have here the RF signal, which is received by the antenna. And then we have an IQ mixer again, but now operating as a down converter. And the output of the IQ mixer is the in-phase signal and the quadrature signal. This is the signal is converted to the digital domain. And now the I branch serves as the input to the real part of the complex number, and the Q branch serves as the input of the imaginary part to the QAM constellation. And now this part here does the inverse mapping of the real imaginary value pair to the symbol here. And now you get a symbol stream, which is of course noisy. Don't forget that there is noise here in the system. And the data detection now decodes the symbols to the bit stream, which can then be processed by a computer. Yeah, and noise is an important keyword. So how does the number of discrete states in the QIM system is related to the signal to noise ratio? So in the previous two videos, we have talked about the parameter KM, so the number of discrete states and noise, and we've learned that the more discrete states a symbol can have, the better the signal to noise ratio must be. So we see what does this mean to our QAM technique here. So we have two examples, two QAMs with a different number of discrete states. So in the left example, we have four discrete states. This is also called the QPSK. And then we have another example with 16 discrete states. So again, the QPSK can encode 2 bits in one symbol, and the 16 QAM can encode 4 bits in one symbol. So the 16 QAM has a double data rate by retaining the same transmission bandwidth, because the symbol pre-read is equal. And now we depict the constellation diagrams of the two QAMs with the different parameters, and we have an important assumption: the signal power is equal. Yeah, so the distance between the boundary values here is equal in both cases. So here it's the same maximum amplitude that the signal can have. That's important, of course, when we speak about the signal to noise ratio. And now let's see what happens if we have noise. So if we have just weak noise, so here in the center is our ideal value for the state. Now we add some noise, and the noise makes the actual value shift away from the center point, which would be here. Yeah, but here the red circles depict our detection boundaries. So this is so if the signal, the received signal, is within the red circle, then the respecting symbol is assigned. Yeah, and yeah. So you see that for weak noise or very good signal to noise ratio, the symbols can be reliably decoded. same applies here for the 60 in QAM. So almost equal noise conditions. So and everything is in between the red circles here, and all symbols can be reliably decoded. And now the noise gets stronger. So there are some disturbances and the noise floor is raised, and the signal to noise ratio is quite poor. And here, so we have stronger noise. So you see that the noise amplitude is higher, so it can even go out of the red circle. But however, most of the values are in the red circle. So in this case, the signal can be reliably decoded. But if we go to the 16 QAM at the same noise amplitude here, we see that the value hits other circles. So for example here, the actual symbol is here, but the value the current value also hits the neighbor circles. So there can be an error, and the stronger the noise is, the higher is the symbol error rate, and therefore the bit error rate. You can also add much more noise. Here it's not good, but it can be reliably decoded. But if we add the same noise here, then it's a catastrophe. So we cannot decode the data at all. And as I said, modern communication systems are adaptive, so they can change the parameter KM according to the noise conditions. So this can be adaptive, so that the communication system has always an optimization between a good data rate and a reliable transmission of the data.